Hey, Dennis.
Hi everybody, who is Fireflies.ai note taker? Anybody know? Huh. I wonder if it's a software application that can sign into Zoom to take notes. I've heard of Fireflies.ai, but I'm not familiar with it. Interesting. All right. How's everybody doing today?
Life's treating me pretty good, Dennis. Hope it is you.
Yeah, good. I understand you met John Andrews.
Yes, met him on Monday. Been in touch with him on a couple other Skype calls over this week and been meeting some representatives in his company. Been enjoying the opportunity.
Fantastic. He's an interesting guy.
Yeah, I met with him and Buddy Bingle, who's a restaurant entrepreneur in New Bern. So that was quite interesting.
Fantastic. What did you guys talk about?
I was able to kind of pitch what we were doing, get both their feedback. He told me what they were doing. And, you know, they both looked at me and said, "You really don't need us. What can we do?" And he goes, You pretty much, we need to work on something together and really partner and work towards a goal together. So that was very exciting for me.
Yeah, that's very cool. I don't know Buddy. John has told me about him, and I know he's owns a minor league baseball team and is involved in a lot of businesses in New Bern. So he seemed like a real interesting guy. I'm going to be meeting him at some point also. So that's great.
Yeah, 38 years old, multiple restaurants, plus the minor league sports team. And what we were doing, he said, man, this would be great for all the baseball stadiums to kind of sell season tickets.
Yeah, very cool. All right.
And I literally just got out of a meeting with a vice president of estimating with a construction company, which was a pretty fun meeting to get through.
Oh, interesting. Good. How did your meetings go in Richmond?
Richmond, we had kind of had a return of events. The guy was scared off by a non-compete and pretty much told us he was going to be our competitor. So that, you know, that's business for you, ebbs and flows.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, wish him well and then, you know, put him out of business, right?
Hey, business is war without bullets.
Yeah, I don't know. I used to think that. I'm not so sure now. It's such a big world now that I guess it can be, but it's better if you think bigger and not get too caught up in that kind of stuff.
Well, you know, it's not the first time that's happened this year. We tried to get somebody in Charlotte and they said, well, you know what, I'm gonna just do it myself. He called me last week and tried to get me to buy his equipment. And so, you know, we offer a lot of value, but so many more people are coming on. I'll let you take back over.
Okay, no problem. Hey, Sawyer, how you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you guys today?
Good, good. Looking forward to connecting with you next week one-on-one. And
absolutely.
Hear what's going on. Welcome to the group here today.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's worth what you paid for it. Remember that.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Darby, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you today?
I'm doing fine, thanks. What's new in your world?
Oh, all kinds of stuff, I guess.
Give me one thing.
One thing. We launched our Patreon channel yesterday.
Cool.
So I'm working on our intro video for it.
Fantastic.
Trying to get that up and going.
Yeah, make sure you post that in the Slack channel. You might get some folks here supporting you. You never know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'll have to do that. Certainly.
Yeah. All right. Well, I guess we'll get started. Let's see here. I will start my video. All right. Here we are at the Student Center. Okay. Well, thank you all, everybody, for coming in today. And didn't get to talk to everybody. Marcus and Ashley, hello to you guys, and Holly at White's Farm. And whoever Fireflies.ai note taker Dennis is, I can't wait to hear the story of who that is. Fireflies.ai is a new software that takes notes. I didn't realize it could log into Zoom, but apparently it can. So that's pretty cool. I hope we can learn more about that. So today, my goal really is to give you a little insight into how fast growth companies are valued, and kind of a little bit of insight into what happens when they get sold or acquired. Now, I realize not everybody wants to grow really rapidly and sell their business. But my goal really is just to get you familiar with the terminology and kind of what's going on in general so that you're at least aware, even if it isn't necessarily going to apply directly to you. I do want you to be exposed to some of it. So with that, I'm going to go through the acquisition, often considered the first, I think Generation X take acquisition of an online business. I could be wrong on that. But a couple of young guys that sold their company for a lot of money in a very short period of time. And it's called Movement. It's spelled MBMT. Some of you may be familiar with it. So I'm going to go through a little bit about what happened there and why and how they got to the point where they grew so fast, particularly using Facebook ads, which may be interesting to a lot of you. Then we're going to talk about another high growth story. This one is very unusual, even though you're going to be very familiar with the product that we're talking about, or the service. And then the last thing I want to talk about is a company that is venture capital funded, but is designed to be a supplier to small businesses. on the web. Even though they are venture funded, some of you may be familiar with them. Their name is FAIRE, F-A-I-R-E. And we're going to talk a little bit about them and what trends they're seeing for the upcoming holiday season, which may be helpful. So I'm going to share my screen. And let's see here. Okay, we're going to start here. Okay, hopefully everybody can see that, no problem. Okay, so some of you may be familiar with Movado Group. They're a New York Stock Exchange listed company that is pretty significant in size, and they own a bunch of brands you may be familiar with. And they're the group that acquired this company called Movement, or MVMT, as you may know it as. So I just want to go through this announcement and give you some idea of what went on. So the purchase price, which was really a two-part purchase. One is an initial payment of around $100 million that went to the two owners of MVMT. And this, they were in business for 5 years when this transaction took place. It also provides for two future payments that could add another $100 million to them. And these are commonplace when you're acquired by a larger entity and they want to keep your brand going. In some cases, they do not want to keep your brand going, but in this case, they did. And so they're trying to get these folks to continue on the process that they're doing so that they would actually earn another $100 million over time if they meet certain criteria. So I wanted to give you an idea about that. We're going to talk a little bit more about what they did. But in general, MVMT got their sales up to about $70 million over 5 years. Of course, all online. And I see on here, they were a millennial brand, not a Generation Z or X, as I mentioned. So they built a digital brand, if you will. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how they got their products and how all that worked, give you some idea. But they created a brand that had attributes significant to their customers. So it was a brand aimed at millennials in this case. And they did a real good job, obviously, getting this done. So I'm gonna switch here a little bit, and we're gonna go to a different screen if I can pull it all together here. Okay, so let's see here. Sorry about that. Let's see, pushing the screen. Okay, so bear with me a little bit here, and hopefully I can get. Okay, I can get this up. And okay, so now we'll. Can you guys see this on your screen? Anybody comment?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Good. Okay, so this is a little bit more in depth as to what they actually did to go from zero to, in this case, they're saying 90 million, but a large number. And I'm not going to go through every single page. This is posted in the Slack channel, so you can read this as you like. But I thought there were some good things in here that would make sense for you. So first of all, these two guys were friends. They dropped out of college in 2013, and they were supposedly fed up with very expensive watches that were generally only available to rich people. They felt like designer watches could also be useful to people who weren't really wealthy. So here's a little bit of a snapshot of how they built their profile, if you will. So they had 3.5 million Facebook followers, 1 million Instagram followers, 400,000 in a subset of Instagram called Movement for Her. They had over 100,000 posts with the hashtag of the name of their company. And their website did 1.5 million visits annually. So, you know, they're covering the ground, and many of you use social media as well, and your website. So I thought it was interesting the way they spread that out. Just for a second, because this article doesn't go into it, I want to talk about where did MVMT get their watches from? And this is my understanding of what happened. They basically bought their watches from China. And these were inexpensive, relatively speaking, easy to get at that time. And many times they were somewhat similar to well-known brands. You could say they were copied in some cases. In other cases, they were completely different. But they got their products. They themselves did not manufacture anything. They really were just a platform for selling. And they originated their products from a variety of factories, primarily in China. I understand that later on they did get some from the United States. So let's take a look at what they did with Facebook and Instagram. What they did was they put a lot of money into both Facebook and Instagram, running their ads. And we're going to look at some examples of what they did, some of the ads and the way they went about it, which may be helpful to you. They found that Instagram worked better even than Facebook, which I think some of you all have felt the same thing. And on this article, which I also have posted in Slack, you'll be able to download this and see the actual ads or get this article. The one thing that I think is really important is the efforts that they made to build their brand. That's really all they had, if you think about it. They weren't a manufacturer. They really were just selling really cheap watches manufactured overseas. But they did take the time and the effort to learn how to maximize their advertising and their brand building. So I think there's a good lesson. If you get access to this article, I think you'll appreciate some of the stuff that they did. And they really talk about their story all the time. One thing that I think is good, and some of you I think really fit this, is sell the lifestyle, not the product. And what they're talking about there, it's really a brand lifestyle. What are the elements of living a particular kind of lifestyle? You know, in the case of Ashley, maybe with Copper Ashes, maybe it's a more natural, earthy type of brand lifestyle attribute. Some of you have other attributes that would make sense. Cameron with his Tailgate Classics, maybe. You know, I'm not going to try to guess at all the aspects, but the point here is they're really not focusing on the cost and the price of the product. They're focusing on adding this to your lifestyle, into living a lifestyle that many people are interested in doing. And I think that's a really important lesson here. One of the things that they did not scrimp on at all was photos and videos. Now, I don't know the whole story. I think I heard at one point that one of the partners had some experience with photography. I could be wrong on that. But they really invested heavily in the way their products looked in their ads, whether it's you know, Facebook or Instagram or any of them. They really use what are referred to as magazine style ads. And you can see here an example. And here's one for Instagram. So some people call these hero shots. This is a common terminology used on the web. These are photos that really highlight the focus of your brand and your product. And in this case here, they're unusual, but they're quite vivid, I think, and they do convey a sense of style. The other thing that they were really good at is they really limited their copy, and they got some statistics here Their most popular ads only had 5 words. And I think many of you agree with that and know that limiting your text is a smart thing to do in some cases. Now, I don't know how much you all are familiar with split testing. We can get into that when Warren Allen is coming along later on in the class. But the idea is basically to test different groups with the same ad to see which ad does better. So there's a good example here. It outlines the effort to make this figure out, you know, if one does twice as good as the other, then it's worth spending the time to do this kind of split. I think some of you might remember Mo Farhat from Webinopoly. He emphasized A-B split testing. They do that a lot. That's one of the major things that he promoted. So the other thing they did here is they used different ways to film their product, right? So this is what they call a multi-product versus a single shot. Kind of interesting, nice texture. This would not be expensive to take, other than if you know how to take a good photo, a clear photo. This is pretty simple, I think you'd agree. And as is this here, it's just a piece of wood or a table with the picture on it. They did do a little bit of adding text to the photo, which you all are familiar with. In this case, free shipping. Some other call to action can be right on the photo. I'm not going to go into this video, but they did some video ads as well. And as Mo said from Webinopoly, video ads are actually cheaper than image ads. The cost per impression is only about 20% of a photo ad. I thought that was pretty good. I think this is important, and this goes into branding. So they're very consistent with the colors that they use and the palette, color palette, as well as the messaging. So no matter where you run across this particular company, the look, the message, the feel, the look and feel is similar. So I really like that. And that's a really strong example of branding. I think you can get a lot from it. So social proof, I'm not going to get into too much of this, but they do have examples of people, who do a post directly and some associate with an ad. They call them dark posts, but it really is the same thing. It's just a slightly different way to go about it. This one here, I like, the idea of making your customer the hero. You know, we talked a lot about product reviews and how important they are. Well, this kind of thing, a picture or a video of a customer featuring a product that you sold them, talking about it or an interview. In this case, I think it's pretty self-explanatory. It's just a watch in this individual. So I like the way that that was done. I think the idea of hashtags, you all are familiar with that, but the idea, they had over 100,000 hashtags on Instagram alone, and that really is getting your community to post about you and to post them. In this case here, this picture we're looking at, these are people, these are customers with their watch in different scenarios in their life with the hashtag. It's kind of word of mouth marketing, only in a louder voice, if you will. This next thing where we talk about rewards and rewarding customers and really taking care of renewed customers who respond quickly. This goes to customer service, which we are going to talk a little bit about that in the next week or two. How do you get this really fast customer service without having to spend a ton of money to staff up and have a dedicated customer service function? But I think it all goes to the attributes of your brand. What do you stand for? What does the brand mean to people? I think being really responsive to everything, which includes complaints, is a really good idea. And as this example here shows, they had a reputation for being very responsive to messages. So speed, again, we talked about speed of website with Mo. I think that the video that we watched of the individuals with the progressive web app that we talked about, I know is very technical, but the point of that progressive web app is to have a very fast experience, particularly on mobile. So speed is the name of the game in really all aspects of e-commerce these days, not only on the sales side, but also on the customer service side. And what this brand did, really, if you go back to my era, I'm older than most of you, and you know, in the old days, the really high quality advertising was generally found on magazines, fashion magazines, you know, magazines that had national or international footprint. You know, that was really the vehicle that a lot of brands used. Even Sports Illustrated with sports related ads, could be beer, you know, Miller and Budweiser and those guys. Everybody really that used those major magazine ads, they were all very high quality ads. They usually involved models, really good backgrounds. It might be exotic locations, et cetera. Magazines are really not that popular anymore. That some are, but in general, the place to build your brand and to build the quality is in fact on your website, in your social media pages, and your mobile app. This is your chance to make it clear kind of where you fit, where and how a customer, what a customer might be looking for, how they're going to get from you what they need that reinforces you know, what they're trying to do. So I'm going to ask if there are any questions at this point on this subject before we move on to the next one. Anybody have any questions or thoughts? Okay. Well, with that, we'll move on to the next one. So this is kind of an interesting story, and really the purpose of this is really to inspire you. So, and this individual likewise built this business in a 5-year period. So they had 5 years from when they started the business until they sold it. Now, in this case, this individual sold the company for $19 billion, which is a pretty big number, obviously. 33 years old, and he did not spend a penny on advertising. But nonetheless, there were some things here that I thought were germane. So this guy was the founder of WhatsApp, and many of you are familiar with WhatsApp. It's a messaging app that was bought by Facebook fairly recently. And it's actually even more popular in Europe, in the Middle East, and other parts of the world. It's popular in the United States too, but it really got its start in India and other parts of the world that really didn't have much in the way of messaging, particularly on a global basis. So this guy, he was a developer, a self-taught developer, and he worked at Yahoo. And turns out he was probably there at the same time our friend Chad Dickerson, who we listened to on Wednesday, the CEO of Etsy. I wouldn't be surprised if they don't know each other. It's common for companies like Yahoo, Facebook, and others to spin off individuals who then go on to start big companies because they're exposed to the environment of what it takes as to scale a business. So in this case, this guy was born in Ukraine, in a communist village. He grew up with some pretty hard times. I'll go down here a little bit just to share it with you a little bit here. we'll just stop right here. I think I can find it. So he grew up in a household that had no running water. He worked as a janitor when he was a kid. He bought programming books from his local store, but would return them after he read them. When they were sold for $19 billion, they only had 55 employees. And he never spent any money on marketing at all. So I thought that was pretty eye-opening in many ways. So I'm not going to go through all this. Again, this is posted. But the message here is, find something that is not being met by competitors and meet that need. And if you meet the need, you can grow really quickly. I'm not saying you're going to have a $19 billion company. But if you read this article, you'll see that he stayed very focused on a simple idea, which was the ability to have conversations by text using the app that he built. He wasn't a very friendly guy, wasn't a very social guy, seemed to clash with a lot of people, kind of a misunderstood genius maybe in some ways. But the lesson here is, if you find something that meets a need, a big need, you can grow really, really fast, even if you don't have a lot of employees. And in this case, another really interesting attribute is, I'll just go down here for a second. I think I read it here. But they did not make much money. They did not have a lot of revenue. So in fact, sometimes he would charge a dollar to get a WhatsApp account just so he could raise some money for a while, and then he'd turn the dollar off. But his approach, his value, if you will, was gathering all this data on all the messages that were taking place. And that's what appealed to Facebook, is all of this data. So let me just see if I can just zero in on that real quick. Just take me a second here. So he saw that what was happening is that when prior to their launch, the way SMS was used was really for notifications. Hey, are you up? Are you around? And then people would use something else to actually talk. And he figured out that people actually wanted to talk. He built the app, and as you can see here, they added over 300,000 users per day, and that was in India, South America, and Europe. So I think that's pretty cool. Here's the part where it said he had to turn on $1 annual subscription fees to slow down growth. But again, it wasn't revenue as much as the data. Also, go back to the story of Movement Watches. If you read the detail of why Movado bought the brand, it was not about the revenue. The revenue helped set the price, but what Movado was looking for was access to a group of consumers that they felt they could not reach. And in this case, it was millennials. So even though they reached $71 million in revenue, their potential paycheck is $200 million, which is significantly above any profit generated by $71 million in revenue. I think you would agree. To summarize this, this guy's very humble when he gives keynotes. He always tells people he was very, very lucky, which, luck and preparation go together pretty well. But he really focused on growth, not revenue. He focused on growing his company. This was a technical company. I understand it's not the same for all of us. But I did want to tell you this story and provide access to this link. I think it's interesting and may be useful to some of you folks that are looking at technology and high growth potentially, either the company you have now or one you'll have in the future. Okay, are there any questions about WhatsApp or this whole idea of building for growth as opposed to revenue? Anybody have any questions or thoughts on that? Okay, so the last thing I'm going to go to and talk a little bit about a company called FAIRE. So FAIRE, F-A-I-R-E, some of you may be familiar with it. I did look through their listing, and I did not see any of you listed there. I may have missed it, but if you're a brand making stuff, you can list your products on FAIRE and make your products available to retailers all around the world, and particularly in the United States. And FAIRE as an organization, I think is only a couple years old. They are venture funded, very well funded, very sophisticated processes, but they're kind of an alternative, if you will, to going to retailers yourself or emailing or other ways of reaching the market. And I think you'll like some of the stuff that we learned here. So FAIRE had a show in August, a trade show, which they did all online. And there's stuff in here, I think, about the numbers of retailers and the number of brands that participated, but it's many. And I thought it was pretty interesting. So they said that 50% of the brands, those are people who make things, on their marketplace participated in this trade show and received orders from thousands of retailers across all 50 states and 10 Canadian provinces. 26,000 new relationships were made between brands and retailers during the event. 46,000 orders were made. The average retailer purchased from three or four brands to stock their shop. So that's pretty good numbers, I think. 857,000 minutes watching live streams. So these are brands pitching their products and people watching the live stream, 155 per live stream. Keep in mind that these viewers are all retailers. 6,000 brands received orders, which I think is interesting. But this is the reason I wanted to bring this up to this group. So what's going on, at least with this group, as far as buying trends? And this is maybe helpful to some of you all. The most purchased brands were women-owned, handmade, and made in the USA. And I think many of you meet this criteria already. They had a guest speaker who is a big believer that high quality local goods that are transparent in how they were built and where they came from are going to be really, really popular. And here, the top search queries were candles, Christmas, and fall decor. There's a lot more data in here that you can look at if you're interested. Again, I posted this in the Slack channel. The retailers were from all 50 states and all of Canada. Here are the cities that most of them are from. Some of you may already do business in these cities. I thought it was interesting that Brooklyn, New York specifically was mentioned and not New York City. I thought that was very interesting. Keep in mind, this trade show took place during the pandemic, right, in August. But you can see, I don't know if any of these cities or all these cities are on your radar as potential markets, but there they are. Women-owned, handmade, made in the USA are the critical pieces here. The search queries, this is on FAIRE's search engine. You know, Halloween, Christmas, so face mask, obviously. So these are trends you may be familiar with. These are the categories that people bought. Thought it was interesting. Accessories, apparel, kitchen and home, drinkware, so forth. Pretty interesting, I think. FAIRE as an organization, I believe all of you are eligible. I have not looked into it in detail, but all of you are eligible to participate on either side or both sides. You can see here they have a lot more detail, market recap, and details about what happened in this. And they also have a whole bunch of other data that may be helpful for you. So again, I'll post this in the Slack channel. But I thought it was pretty cool. And what I like about this from my perspective is it's a very high quality branding execution. This is obviously a high quality marketplace. It is not a place for low cost trinkets like you might see from other marketplaces. So I found that to be very helpful. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing and I'm going to open it up to questions, ideas, reactions from the group. Hopefully I've successfully turned off screen sharing. I think I did. Okay. So Marcus.
Yes.
What did you think about the WhatsApp guy and that whole story?
Well, he found an area. He found an area that nobody was in. So or he used technology that already existed to create a new way to communicate. And we look at stuff like that all the time within our company. And to see if there's any way we can reverse engineer something that already exists to give consumers better experiences or service dealership personnel better experiences. And, I love his story. I mean, I followed that guy several times. I mean, a lot over my entrepreneurial journey. And, I think it's great. I like the thing with FAIR. I like that data that you showed. That's good.
Okay. All right, Ashley. Let me ask Ashley, what do you think, Ashley, about anything really, but about FAIR or anything else we talked about?
Well, I thought it was really cool how one of the things about like the more successful, or maybe not successful, but popular businesses were women-owned, handmade in the United States or whatever kind of businesses. And I don't know, I've seen so many people that do the same kind of craft or whatever as me, but I guess don't run it as successfully. So I don't know. It was just interesting to see that kind of information. And I kind of like see that a lot of other small businesses online that maybe do similar things or crafty things, but they have been successful with it. So yeah, I just thought that was really interesting.
Okay. Do you think that a market like FAIR would be useful for you at some point?
I'm not sure. I'd have to look into it a lot more, I guess.
Yeah. Well, it basically is reaching retailers who would sell your product.
Yeah, because I've thought about stuff like that, but I'm not entirely sure. Yeah, I guess I'm not quite to that point.
I'll mention about that real quick. The story that you were talking about, Movement, that was bought out by Movado. A couple of years ago, I was still working a full-time job, I got on Alibaba and I bought 500 pairs of sunglasses. And I went on Fiverr.com and had somebody whip me up a logo real quick. And I created these shades called Dash Shades. And I just ran some Facebook ads on them. And I mean, I was just selling out of them, left and right. And I got away from that. I mean, I didn't continue to do it, but back to their story where they were able to really grow their company across Facebook ads. It's just really, there's a large opportunity there for e-commerce.
Yeah. What did you do with the website? Did you just shut it down at some point?
Yeah, I did. I just had too much going on. I needed to focus on the more important things. And although I was making a lot of money on the side, I mean, I still have people today call me and say, hey, do you have any more shades left?
I love it. Well, we may need to talk to you because one of the companies in our group is a sunglass site called Alluring Shade. So maybe you can act as a technical consultant for her at some point over the phone or whatever. That's great. Has anybody else in the group dabbled in this kind of thing other than what you're doing now? Anybody?
As far as like buying and reselling?
Yeah.
I mean, I used to do a lot of buying used comic books and DVDs and stuff like that and reselling them. Like when I was really in middle school through high school, that was like my side money and that was fun. I guess that's what kind of got me started on just e-commerce stuff.
That's so cool. I love it. Where did you build a little website and sell the stuff?
No. So I was mainly through eBay. I just had my own little eBay shop that my mom ended up like, you know, co-running with me because I was only 13, I think. And I ended up buying like these comic books and stuff like that. And then like in bulk from, you know, libraries and things like that and just reselling them or even yard sailing and finding antiques and things that I would resell. And that was like a fun side thing for me that really got me into like, oh, I like doing this, selling online.
Wow, that's a story that you need to tell. That's phenomenal. I love that. That is so cool. I'll tell you all some of my stories that might be of interest to you. So back in the 90s, I started out really working with large corporations and their senior management and boards of directors on basically financial related things. But when I left that, stopped doing that, I was approached by a friend of mine who had been selling computer-related stuff to the federal government. At that point, he'd been doing it for 10 years. And he had like two or three partners. They had a warehouse. And they sold literally like IBM computer and all the related parts that you can imagine. You know, which I didn't even know existed, right? I just thought a computer was a computer. But they sold, you know, all these little parts and printers and everything you could think of. So I just started looking into a little bit of what they were doing. I said, why don't we take a shot at selling this online? And so two of the four partners in the business thought it was a great idea. Make a long story short, we ended up building a website and it was called Club Computer, clubcomputer.com. And the model was really based on Costco and Sam's Club, where we charge $50 a year and you would get the lowest price on any of these computer products. And we went to a major computer distributor, which at the time was called Maricel, was their name. There were two others. And we connected electronically into their warehouse so that their 55,000 products would appear on our website individually as products that people could buy. And then we went to, at that time, there was a website called shopper.com that was run by CNET. And so everybody that was selling computer related stuff were on this marketplace and you could pay a fee to get your listing higher than another. And they even had a top of the line fee where you would always be listed in the first three or four if your product was competitively priced. So I hired a software developer and he wrote, he called it an agent. I'm not quite sure it's the right terminology, but what it would do is it would look at all of the parts that all of our competitors were selling and would make us one penny cheaper automatic. So we came out number one in every single product for about a year and a half. And we did 55 million in sales on that website. Which is pretty crazy. And long of all story, I'll tell you another time, maybe over a beer or something, but the bottom line was, it was a gigantic market that I never knew even existed. We ended up, we were a tiny little company. Some of the companies, are now giant companies. I can't remember their names. They had a different name back then, but some of them were owned by groups in Singapore and China and all this kind of stuff. But we rocked it for about a year, a little over a year. And I was living in the country in a rural area. I had no employees, no infrastructure of any kind, just a website and a connection to a large distributor's database. So that was my introduction to e-commerce. I thought it was very cool. So. Anyone else have anything that they want to add? All right. Well, if that's the case, I'm going to wish everyone a good weekend. And if you haven't made your one-on-one appointment yet, please be sure you do that. And, you know, if there's anything I can do, please reach out and check out the Slack. There's all the stuff I had today is on there if you want to look at it in more detail. And I appreciate everyone coming and appreciate you in general. Take care, everybody.
Yeah, thank you. You have a good weekend, Dennis.
You too. Bye-bye.
All right. Thank you.